Finally, the rain in Sydney has stopped and work resumes on the site. The brickies can start constructing the garage and the retaining walls. The terrace slab will soon be poured, and with the help of a little sunshine, everything seems to be going well. But there's still that one nagging problem.
The only hassle we are finding is the water problem. Apparently there's a spring in the rock, you know, rock shelf up above, and because we're low, we're getting all the water, the runoff water out of the spring. So we've just got to deal with it and try and get rid of it as best we can. I did suggest to Julie that she might be able to bottle it, but we'll wait and see.
Because of the constant runoff, they're now having to re-engineer the site, build additional concrete retaining walls and buttresses, pour in over 35 tonnes of crushed rock, build 6 drainage pits, and install not one, but 2 pumps, just to remove the water table from the construction area. When Patrick and Julie bought this, what looked like an innocuous property, they had no idea that there was this running under the property 24/7, enough to fill up their swimming pool once a week, every week of the year. But I suspect that the soil is so waterlogged, there's no way it will support a 2-storey building on timber stumps. Not only is water pouring down this drain, so is Patrick and Julie's money. In the middle of all this, Patrick squeezed in a 4-day trip home, and Julie wants to make the most of it.
Hey, there's our light.
So she's lined up a busy itinerary.
And Patrick's already picked up the one at the front, but yeah, it's ours.
Uh-huh. Julie's actually gone out of her way to keep me connected. You know, she a lot of the decisions, she drags me in, you know, even when I feel I don't necessarily need to be dragged in or something, but she's been really good at making me part of the process.
What better way to top off Patrick's fleeting visit than with a sneak peek of the new prefab house?
That looks great.
That's not ours, is it?
Yes. Oh,
yes, it is.
This is one of the joys of prefab building.
That's nice. The hairs on the back of my neck are standing up.
Seriously?
Being able to walk around your house and explore it just 8 weeks after the start of construction, when even the foundations haven't been laid.
Hey, Julie, I've got a sliding door. That's going to be fantastic, isn't it?
I'm thrilled. I mean, it's just huge.
Each piece is huge, and there are 4 of them. How the hell are they going to get that on a truck?
Trucking issues aside, there's a lot of money invested, $1.2 million to be exact, to finesse these prefab shells into a carefully detailed, top-end architectural home.
It's going.
Good.
Because it's ugly.
Normally, these houses are built with the rigours of transportation in mind, but in wanting to create a totally prestige home, Patrick and Julie are using very expensive materials.
Oh, the zinc. Peel it back, show me.
That looks fantastic, doesn't it?
That is going to be incredible.
And how far will travel is completely untested.
This is the Ryan zinc cladding that's going to cover the upper portions of this building. It's a beautiful, lustrous material, but if it's dented, you can't replace it. They have to take the whole wall lining off in air, on site, to replace it. And I understand Rob, the factory manager, is not protecting this on the way to site. It's a bit risky if you ask me.
With Patrick now heading back to Singapore, it's Julie flying solo once more.
Look, as far as personal costs go, yeah, I think it's been huge. Patrick and I would rather be living together in the same country, in the same state, in the same house, quite frankly. But it's not how it's worked out. I mean, I don't know of many men who would let their, you know, partners run a project of building their house, would trust their judgment, and I just, you know, thank him from the bottom of my heart for doing that. Now I'm getting emotional. You know, I just think he's been very brave to let me do it.
We can see we've over-excavated for all the retaining walls.
Yep.
Even though they've spent tens of thousands of dollars coping with the water problem, the ground is still wet and unstable. and most certainly in no condition to support the proposed footings.
So essentially, the sooner the engineer gets up here and has a look at the site conditions, the better.
I want to show you a problem that Patrick and Julie have got, and it's well demonstrated on this beach. The surface feels nice and firm, but underneath the surface, it's another story. As I dig down, the water table wants to fill the hole. And the more I dig, I want to get the water out of the hole, the more it drags in the soil around it. What they've got is a hydraulic problem. Most people would call it, though, a bowl of soup. Securing a two-storey house on soil like this will require specialist and expensive engineering.
We've had no rain here for 4 weeks.
Yeah.
So it's just constantly running off. It was just pools here, mountains of it.
Yeah. I like the idea of concrete ones.
Yeah. So timber stumps weren't really going to work all that well, so concrete stumps look like the outcome, and I think it's probably the right outcome.
Re-engineering the site for concrete piers 12 weeks into construction will affect many of the contractors.
Given the amount of water that's coming off the block at the moment, yes, you're right, it could flood, and you don't want any electrical stuff in the way, do you?
So it's a scramble to get everyone across the revised plans.
This is the first site that I've dealt with that had this amount of water on it. It's, as you can see, those piers there, they were only dug yesterday, and they're full of water now.
Work on the 36 large concrete piers that are replacing the timber stumps goes ahead. They've been taken down 1.5 metres to the bedrock, an extreme but necessary measure given the circumstances. It's sure to be costly.
The house bearing on the pier, bearing on the rock, won't move at all. So actual rock bearing piers, brilliant.
Essentially, it was two boxes and then two on top.
With the footings issue resolved, the next question is how to manoeuvre the four enormous modules onto a site bound by very narrow and sloping access.
As far as weights and that go, it's a little bit of a educated guess.
Yeah, I've been told around 17 tonne.
Well, that'd be...
each one?
Close, yeah.
So you wouldn't want any wind, would you, really?
With the site and the sloping of the road, obviously we need to try to lift the modules as level as we can.
It must be done with scalpel-like precision, as one slip-up could spell disaster.
If we don't get it right, you know, essentially that's our money just gets broken.
These units weigh over 17 tonnes each and are about to travel 900 kilometres to Sydney, where they must marry the on-site foundations perfectly, with an accuracy tolerance of under 5 millimetres. After 4 months in the making, finally the moment of truth, as Patrick and Julie's house is separated into the four modules and made ready for its journey.
I think we've executed it quite well, and just doing all of that in a very short time frame has probably been the biggest challenge, and everyone's feeling that pressure a bit at the moment. But I think it's going to work out well. We're happy to be seeing it going out of the factory, definitely. There's still quite a bit of work to be done once we get to Sydney, and it's always nervous times, you know, putting, you know, this sort of size house on the truck.
Getting out of the factory is one thing. Getting into Sydney with its narrow sloping streets is another. And look at the size of these things. They barely fit on the highway. Patrick and Julie's million-dollar house is on the road, making the 900-kilometre journey to Sydney. Jim's driving the lead truck in the convoy, which includes four support vehicles that will expand to eight once we get to Sydney.
So, what are your main concerns?
Idiots on the road that don't understand how big you are.
Are you surprised that there's not more protection on the buildings?
For what they say the cladding's worth, yes, I am surprised that they didn't put anything else over it.
Jim will get this load to Sydney by the early hours of tomorrow morning by driving non-stop in convoy. They'll set up base camp just outside Sydney and wait for instructions. But between now and then, it's a long trip when any lapse of concentration could be disastrous.